We have with us here today Aneesh Gokhale, who's a very dynamic young author and who's really been, you know, who's burst onto the Indian writing scene. And so we have the privilege of talking to him today about some of his work. So Aneesh, first of all, welcome to the Pondy Lit Fest.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
And so we would just like to know from you what you think of Pondicherry and what do you think about it hosting a Lit Fest?
I think it's a very beautiful place. It has got a old world charm kind of thing, and all those things which the larger cities are now missing. It doesn't have the rush of a modern city. People rushing in the morning, one direction, evening, second direction. So that kind of not there. It has a lot of heritage. Which is still existing, so it creates a very charming place. And I think there are very few places in the country which have this kind of a setup for the city or the town. A lot of the places in the country, if you see the old parts, you'll find that they are in state of perpetual decay, sort of. But the old part of Pondicherry is in fact in a very good condition. And it's being kept that way, a lot of heritage value. So it's a beautiful place to be in, and of course the Lit Fest, I believe it's a great place to hold a Lit Fest for two reasons. One is of course the ambience of the place. It's easily accessible, in the sense that once you are in Pondicherry, it's very easy to get to these places that are hosting the Lit Fest, for example. Or even if you are in Chennai or Bangalore, it's a very accessible place. Something that I believe is an advantage over holding Lit Fest in, say, a large city. So if you do it in a Mumbai or a Delhi, you might hold a Lit Fest at one place and people might be 15, 20, 25 kilometers away, accommodated. But that kind of thing is not there here. So it creates a real nice ambience for the Lit Fest kind of an event. And secondly, of course, it's associated with Sri Aurobindo Ghosh, who is of course a very tall figure, not only in the Indian freedom struggle, but also in the literary world and spiritual world. So Pondicherry, when you think of Pondicherry, obviously Aurobindo Ghosh's name is one of the first that are associated with it. In fact, I would say that many people will not associate any other name with Pondicherry. And so when you bring these two facets together, you will find that Pondicherry is in fact a great venue to be hosting a Lit Fest.
Wow, that's great insight. And as you've been known to write about historical topics, what would you really say? Like, we see students these days, and history is a subject that they don't really relate to. So do you think there's something wrong with how history is being taught in our country today? And Do you think a change can be made to that?
Yes. See, you raise a point about not being able to relate to, which I think is correct, because you need to have something in your textbooks that people, children, that they can identify with, For example, even if you take Hollywood movies, reason, the moment you find out there is an Indian actor in it, or you find out that, so-and-so scene has been done in India, your interest goes up for no reason. You don't know what the story is, you don't know what the movie is going to be about, but just because there is an Indian actor in it, you will feel that there is some kind of connect with that, okay? And I believe the same thing goes also for history, that when you're reading, or any kind of textbook you're reading, that child reading that book should be able to relate to something that is happening in his real life, that he can touch, he can see. You'll find that children are very enthusiastic about physics, about science, as compared to history. Why? Because they have a science laboratory in which they are taught Newton's first law of inertia. They send one ball from here, one ball comes out the other end. They can actually see that science happening. They cannot see that history. Why? Because two reasons. One is that we have history that is very Delhi-centric. Now, it's very difficult for a 12-year-old, 13-year-old child to imagine Mughal architecture just by looking at photos. Many pages of photos also not there. We're just reading about it. Okay? So, this causes a disconnect. But I don't know what this is. Somebody lived in some city 2,000 miles away. I mean, if you are from Pondicherry and you're reading about Babar and Humayun, you'll find that place is 4,000 miles away. And I don't know what is this, when I talk about Mughal architecture, Red Fort, I have not seen it. It's not easy. I mean, people don't get up and go to Delhi every single day. So you need to have history that people can relate with. And a point I want to make here is that we should have more of local history, you know, of your own town, of your own city, of your own state. It is far more possible for a child in Pondicherry to go to Chennai. It's only 3 hours away. Most probably 90% of the kids in Pondicherry have a relative in Chennai. You have this French architecture in Pondicherry, which has its own heritage. And I mean, leave aside the colonial part, but of course there is a heritage part. And it's something that they can see and touch. So this kind of local history is not covered in our curriculum, which I believe causes a disconnect. People then start not being able to relate with those topics. And eventually the conclusion is that history is a dry subject because you can't relate with it. As opposed if you include, so for example, if you are in Mumbai and you put the history of the railways in the textbooks, or you put the history of Mumbai itself in the textbooks. So a child who goes to say the Chhatrapati Shivaji terminus, the station, and he sees it and he realizes that this photo is there in my textbook, I have been taught 2 pages about it, is going to create an interest in the topic. But I believe the whole crux about history in school is to create an interest for a topic. No deep study is happening there. You can't study anything deep in school. It's just one textbook. So, that is the situation you should have. But the whole crux should be towards creating an interest in history and using the historical monuments and events first on a local scale before, you know, try to impose something that is not they cannot relate with.
Sure, yes, absolutely. And but for you personally, like, how did you get so interested in history and especially with the Marathas, and how did you actually come about get down to writing the book that you wrote?
I always like to read. Reading has always been a habit with me since very young age. And as far as Marathi history is concerned, I also like trekking and hiking, I told you. So I could actually imagine that history by actually going to the forts. You know, you go to the fort, you see and you imagine as to how can this place have been captured. It looks impregnable to you. But then you go into history. You start appreciating, and once you really go into it in this kind of manner with an interest is generated by treks and by seeing those places, then obviously one thing led to another, and I decided to write a book which was on Maratha history first, and my second book was on Assamese history, on Lachit Borphukan. So once I had an interest in history, it became more of an interest in legal history, because that is what concerned Maratha history. I'm leaving history, obviously, then became more broad-based. And as far as Assam is concerned, I read Amar Chitra Katha on Lachit Borphukan. And since then, his persona had been imprinted on my mind, is that, he's a very great person which nobody knows about. And once I finished one book, I thought, why not explore more about Lachit Borphukan and the Assamese society and medieval Assam? Because it's a totally unknown topic, but at the same time, it is very linked to medieval Indian history. It's not something that keeps happening just in the Northeast and not related to what's happening in India. No, it is the Mughal Empire, it is there. We have the same names. We have Dilair Khan, we have Ram Singh, we have Chhatrapati Shivaji, we have Aurangzeb. So all these names which are occurring very frequently or very, the broad-based kind of way in medieval Indian history, also there in Assamese history. So obviously there is a link there. It is not. And so a defeat of the Mughal army in Assam is something that people should be knowing about, which is why I brought out my second book called Brahmaputra, which is on Lachit Borphukan.
Great. And do you have any other books coming up, like any more ideas to write or something that you've been working on?
I actually also write history column for DNA newspaper. I've written history articles for Swarajya, for Rightlog, for India Facts, or maybe a couple of them for mind.net, and some blog posts. So all of them put together now come to around 50-52 articles throughout. So maybe I'll next come up with a compilation of all these. Okay. And as far as books are concerned, I'll be beginning work on a book on Odisha, as you call it now. Again, as similar to Assamese history or Northeast history, Odisha is one more place where people know very little about, as far as history is concerned. lot of people think Odisha's history is connected straight to Bengal's history, thanks to our history textbooks. Basically, we find Odisha's mention one at Kalinga, when Ashok and his edict. And the second mention of Odisha is at the Battle of Plassey, where you find that after winning Battle of Plassey, the Diwani of Bengal, Orissa and Bihar was given to the British, which is not entirely correct, because most of Orissa at that point of time was still under the Marathas. And then if you go further into Orissa's history, you will find that it is totally disjointed from Bengal's history. Bengal, for example, fell under an Islamic invasion at 1206 AD. Okay, some part of it, yes, survived in what is today's Bangladesh, but mainly it has been annexed in 1206. But you would find that Orissa has not been annexed by a foreign power up to 1568 AD. So there is a 360-year gap, which I was surprised to find. I think it's totally unknown that Orissa kept itself independent for 3.5 centuries after Bengal had disappeared, and good 100 years after even their kingdoms to their west and south had gone under Alauddin Khilji. So this is part of history I'd like to explore, as to what really kept the Odisses or the province of Odisha free, and the people who made it possible. So that I'll be exploring, and maybe 2-3 years time I should be able to come up with a book.
Wow, that is extremely fascinating, and yeah, we look forward to that very much. And is there any book that really inspired you, that you read and which you were inspired by, and which you would like to suggest to our readers, something that you know that you came across and found great and you would like to share?
There are quite a few books that way. Talking specifically of Maratha history, from a reference book point of view, there is by G.S. Sardesai. He's written, I think, English translation available of that. A very good book on Maratha history by Sardesai. And also book by Veer Savarkar called Six Golden Epochs of History. Some points of those books, that book is a bit extreme, but the general idea that he puts forward is correct. And I put this idea forward good 70-80 years ago, when you know this kind of thought was just not there. And he makes a point about how we have a very defeatist outlook towards history, that we tend to see our entire history in terms of a series of defeats. You know, this invader came, that invader came, we did nothing, then we got ruled, then one more invader came, we continued getting ruled. And so this is the wrong rendition of history. And he tries to set out the times in a reverse manner, that your continuous struggle was going on. This person fought, fine, they finally fell. But 100 fights have taken place where finally we got under foreign rule. And so that that book is very good if you take the essence of it, how to approach history from a different point of view as compared to what is being taught currently. So definitely these are two. I mean, there are many I can suggest, but they're different to say these things. Couple of them are really good as far as history is concerned.
Well, thanks a lot for the recommendation. And finally, you must have seen, like, with us holding this Lit Fest, we've had a fair bit of opposition, and there have been some protests and everything. So, do you have anything to say about this phenomenon? You know, like where an event happens for the first time, and then we have protests. Like anything that you would want to say about that, or something you would want to.
Well, I mean, I think it's very unfortunate that before the event has taken place, the protests are taking place. I mean, you don't even know what's going to be spoken. And I think it's unfortunate. People cannot really appreciate a different point of view. Like I said, I mean, a particular point of view has been reinforced throughout the education as far as history and social sciences are concerned. And it has been taken that this is the correct opinion, and all other opinions are false. And I believe the Lit Fest is just about putting up a second opinion. A debate basically happens when you have two opinions. If you have just one opinion, then there is no debate, is it? So it is really sad that this kind of protest did happen, but let us hope that from next time onwards, you have a more vibrant Lit Fest, where you have a confluence of ideas and a real debate between different ideologies taking place, rather than just be a situation where, you know, one side says, no, you are wrong, we are protesting, you won't come here. And the other side says, no, we are this way, not that way. So the whole idea of Lit Fest, I believe, is to encourage debate and dialogue and have a variety of thoughts coming together at one place, even if they are 180 degrees apart. So I hope that does happen in the future.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Aneesh. And yeah, okay. And we
thanks
do hope that everyone gets this message, and maybe going forward we have, like, you know, a truly inclusive Lit Fest where everyone takes part. And because that's really what we want to do, we want to have, you know, all different opinions and all different perspectives, and
exactly.
Have something that everyone can enjoy, and especially the literary world out there who wants to, you know, hear from their heroes, their authors.
Yes,
so that's
the whole idea of Lit Fest should be to, you know, have an exchange of ideas, and so that people can take maximum out of it. You don't know. I mean, there could be some very good arguments from the left. I've not seen many of them as yet, but let us presume there are some. And so let's see what happens. And plus, at the same time, I would say the Lit Fest or the fields associated with the left are also open-minded towards, you know, a second or a third opinion or a different opinion as compared to what they are comfortable. But I think there is also a point that they are grown comfortable in their opinion, and something to the contrary they just cannot accept. So the whole point comes to about being able to listen to a different voice.
Yes, absolutely. And yeah, thanks a lot for being part of the Lit Fest and for sharing your wisdom with us. And yeah, we look forward to you coming here, you know, every year whenever it's possible. So
definitely,
yeah, welcome to the Lit Fest, welcome to Pondy.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.